Hello, my name is Mads, and I have this little presentation about how we work with strength and conditioning in especially badminton, but table tennis as well in Denmark. I'm employed by Team Denmark, and I've worked with badminton and table tennis since 2009. So I hope you like it.
First of all, what am I going to talk about? There's a lot of stuff involved in strength and conditioning, and a lot of stuff going around other places as well. So first of all, what is Team Denmark? Who am I? How do we work? Second of all, understanding the sport of badminton, which is what I'll go into here. And then try to say something about what we actually do. And maybe you think I'm going to give you a lot of answers. I'm probably going to present a lot of questions instead, I think. First of all, I guess it's important to state that when you work with elite sports in the place I do, we don't have any control. So what we do is based on the assumption that when we do something and somebody wins a medal, we did it right. But we're not sure because we have no control. So maybe they would have done better if we didn't interfere. Maybe we actually did help them, but we're not really sure because we have no control in this issue. The way we work in Denmark with elite sports is we have Team Denmark, which is an elite sports organization. So we put in the world to try to help the different federations doing elite sports. So if we look at Team Denmark, then we have a lot of different federations doing the sport, knowing a lot about the sports. Together with them, we try to figure out how to evolve and how to be the best in the world, hopefully. We have 24 federations that are able to get support from Team Denmark, qualified for that. 8 world-class federations and 16 elite federations. So if you do really well, you can probably get more. That's kind of how the system is. So if you succeed, we can help you maybe take the last step. And we'll try to help the elite federations growing up and being at the same level as the world-class federations. So almost 1,100 athletes, 4 strength and conditioning coaches to handle those. So as you can see, we don't have the concept of an embedded scientist in Denmark. We haven't got the resources for that, so we're split out. And that means that I'm working with badminton, but I'm also working with swimming, table tennis, and parasports. Badminton is a world-class federation, swimming is a world-class federation, so these are the sports that I spend the most of my time at. But if you look at the full-time employment, it's about 30% of my full-time that goes to badminton. So being a sport that competes at top level in the world, it's not much that they get. And that's maybe the problem in our system, we don't have the funding. Our system builds on something we call the Danish Way, maybe people outside Denmark call it that as well. Where if you imagine that we have kind of an athlete career or athlete life going up here, then the concept is that it builds on some kind of foundation. And we have nothing, almost nothing to do with that foundation. So usually you say in Denmark, clubs and the federations are handling this. This is their job, so to speak. This is what the Danish Way looks like. And hopefully, natural selection and expertise, the right places, will push somebody up through and give us a flux of athletes that can actually qualify and can go all the way. And we try to be the icing on the cake up here to see if we can take someone who's brought up at a certain area and see, can we take them the last step? Important point in this is communication. I might have an expertise, and that expertise might even be able to help some athletes, but if I can't bring that into play, it's not worth anything. So if I stand up and start shouting about what I think they should do, because I think I know what they should do, they might not listen, and this is not really a good platform for communicating. So this is a concept we try to do, that we should listen to understand and not to reply. And I've heard a guy once say that you have one mouth and 2 ears, so you should at least listen twice as much as you talk. Maybe even more, especially if you're new in a sport. And as I haven't worked with badminton before I started in Team Denmark working with them, it's not my expertise in badminton, it's my expertise in strength and conditioning, I need to apply to a field I don't know, so I need to listen. The exciting thing is that when you talk to athletes, you talk to coaches, you talk to scientists, you need to be able to communicate at different levels, because they're of course not at the same level. Athletes do not know what scientists know, but scientists do not know what athletes know, or feel anyway. And in the perfect world, we always think that athletes listen to the coach, and the coach listens to scientists, because the scientists state some objective truths about how things function. And in real life, it tends to look like athletes listen to athletes, coaches listen to coaches, and scientists listen to scientists. So our job in Team Denmark is to stand with a foot in the science camp and a foot in the athletes and coaches camp, and see if we can build bridges between these areas. And when we try to build these bridges, it's mainly important, first of all, to be with the athletes, to be with the coaches, so they get to know me, I get to know them, and I get to know the culture. Have a law of the three T's stating that things take time. So be patient. You can't change a culture in a sport overnight, even though sometimes we would really like to do that. The next thing is that if you changed it overnight, you wouldn't be able to learn from it. So sometimes if we spend time just observing and being there instead of trying to change things, we learn why some things shouldn't be changed. And the last issue, I think, is that we should be trustworthy. It's very easy if you're put in an expert role and people expect something from you. It's easy to start thinking, I need to change something to show why I'm here and to show them that I know what I'm talking about. And if you do know what you're talking about, of course you should try, but if you're in doubt, you should probably give it a little time. And if you help them with something, if you promise them that something will happen if they do this and that, and it doesn't happen, you're pretty much out, usually. So our secret key, I think, to success in this area is NASA. And not space tech, although that would be extremely cool, but talking with the athletes, taking the athletes along for the ride. So first of all, establishing there is a need for something, intervention, something we need to take out. If there's a need, are we all accepting that this is the need? This is what you need to improve. You need to be faster, you need to be slimmer, you need to be stronger. Do we accept that? Do the athlete accept that? So that's the one thing. If they don't agree with us, it's pretty hard to make them do what we think we should do. Number two is the solution. We have to agree on a solution. So if the athletes don't want this solution, but some other solution, they probably won't do what we ask of them. So we need acceptance of this point as well. So we try always to go at it this way and say, is there a need? Yes, there are. Yes, there is. Are we agreeing that this is the need? Yes. Are we agreeing that this is the way we're going to solve that issue? Yes, we agree on that as well. Okay, let's go. Everybody's on the wagon. Then we have tons of meetings, but the main meetings, I think, are important here, are these ones. So the NASA meetings, that when we want to do something, if we want to do an intervention, that the coach, the relevant experts from Team Denmark, and the athletes sit down, either in a group or just one athlete, and discuss, this is our plan, this is what we think we should do, are you going to commit to this? And if they say no, we will say, okay, we'll try to find out something else. Because if we don't bring the athlete along, they will maybe say yes and not do it, or they will just say no and then find another expert that will do something else. So we can't dictate anything. We can't force them to do anything. But we can bring them along, and if we inform them, they probably, hopefully, will go along with us. So check-ins or brush-ups, where I go to the hall where they train, or they come to the gym, or we meet in an office somewhere and have a cup of coffee and discuss how are things going, what should we do, are things going along what we thought it would. So a lot of informal meetings, I think, is actually much better than 1,000 very formal meetings. So that brings us on to the strength and conditioning area. We try to say that when we work with strength and conditioning, it's easy to say that this is what we build our medals upon. This is what should discriminate who wins and who loses. And sometimes it does. But most important of all, because we can't be with all the athletes all the time, it's about saying it cannot be the limiting factor.
we need to be able to compete, we need to be able to train enough and train with high enough quality, high enough quantity to be able to compete. So first of all, finding out, okay, what is the limiting factor of what we have in the strength and conditioning area right now? Well, this is power. So we need to build power to be able to improve. And when power is built up and we have no leak here, we probably need to work on the next thing. It could be flexibility. So building on that, I just really like this image. I think it's David Beam from Canada who showed me this once. You can't shoot a cannon from a canoe, they say over there. That's probably true. I think this is a bad idea anyway. This is probably working somewhat better. But the athletes don't know that. So athletes all over the world are constantly shooting cannons from canoes without knowing that they shouldn't do that. So we need to educate the athletes that you can do this. Yes, you might even hit the target, but at some point the boat will turn over and you lose. So if you build the boat stronger, you can do it more times and you can probably even perform better. But if the athletes don't know that, how should they be able to take the right choices? So we really try to educate the athletes, because what we meet out there will always be questions like this. Questions, statements, and we're back to the post-factual world, that you read something or you listen to someone saying, I stopped eating this or that, or I'm now on a chia diet and I never drink milk and now I'm performing. And then loads of badminton players, people in sports all over the world will say, I'm going to do that. It might work for me as well. So we're seeking all these little things that probably will not work. And then we're forgetting to put our emphasis where we know it works, first of all. And if we've done everything right, yeah, okay, let's build on top of other things. But we also have athletes that just want to look shredded, just want to look strong, because if I look strong, people will fear me and they will lose because they fear me. And that's probably not a good idea. So this leads us back to what we hopefully all know, the supercompensation. So you meet up, you start training, you do some kind of training, you do conditioning, you do lifting of some weights, maybe you play badminton, it could be anything. But when you do that, you break down the system a little. If you train too hard, you break down too much. Then time goes by and magically we recover. Especially if this time slot here is long enough, and or if we put quality into this area as well. So that could be all kinds of things. The perfect amount of rest, you eat the right things, you do the right kind of recovery strategies, maybe you're mindful, meditating. All these things can help you in this area. We supercompensate, we get even better, everybody's happy. If we do this wrong, so if we travel a lot, and badminton players travel very much, if we have a bad sleeping hygiene, if we live a stressful life, then the recovery will be worse. It could even be that we train too much and too often, so we don't have the time to recover enough. Then we end here, and no one's happy. So this leads on to where we really want to go. What do you need to be able to perform and win in badminton, and how do we get there? So first of all, Victor is asking a question, what are the characteristics of badminton? And I think we should see that. So looking at this, first of all, it's interesting that people that don't know badminton will say, this looks easy. I still sometimes think, yeah, I can do that. I could probably do that. And I would be nowhere near. So if you look at what they do, there's a lot of lunging, there's a lot of breaking, changing direction. You need a fast arm, you need a strong flick of the wrist. You need to be strong to break yourself in the deep positions. And of course, while they do this, their heart rate will be close to 100% of their maximal working heart rate. So it's not easy, although it might look easy. And that's the thing with really good sportsmen, athletes, is that when you do something that's really difficult, you can still make it look easy because you're that good. So you need a lot of stuff for this. And there's a lot of different ways of building up the body, and there's a lot of freaks of nature. I really, really like to look at sport as a very, very complex area, especially as sport as badminton.
And then I really like to look at, this is a cyclist. This is a cyclist. They're not really alike. This is a runner. This is a runner. They're very, very different. And we have this happy guy up here. Pretty strong, doesn't look like any of the others. So where does badminton fit in here? Well, that's always a discussion that's nice to take. It could be a lot of these places. We need to, I think the classic duel will be about 8 to 10 seconds. So that's not much, so that's short intensive bursts you need to be able to do all the time. But you need to be able to do it up to 2 hours. The women's singles final from Rio was 1 hour and 51 minutes, I think. So that's quite a long time to be able to constantly be explosive, keep momentum, and all this. What we try to do when we talk to the athletes is trying to explain when they say, why should I do strength training? I don't need to be big as a weightlifter. No, true. But you need to be strong as a weightlifter, maybe, without having quite as much size as a weightlifter, or at least getting close in strength. So we try to say, okay, the eccentric strength, why do you need that? Well, you need to be able to lunge forward, break yourself. You need to evolve your maximal strength, because that is one way to kind of make certain you don't get quite as many injuries. At the same time, it's a basis for power, to be strong. You need to be strong before you can be powerful. And of course, lowering the relative load is an important thing here as well. Strength, speed, strength, changing direction, jumping, your deep defense movements, corrections in the footwork, and speed, I guess the smash as being the fastest racket sport in the world, with the world record for a smash being over 500 kilometers per hour. It's pretty high speeds we're talking about here. So if you ask the national coach what he wants us to do with his players, he would say this and this. This and this, probably this, definitely this, this and this. And you would want it done tomorrow, preferably. And I would say, okay, when should we do this? And he would say, you just find somewhere in the annual plan where you can fit it in. And this is pretty complex, and I hate slides like this, so I'll try to break it down really fast. First of all, we have the month, the weeks, the days. Then we have the competitions throughout the year. This is not all the competitions, but most of them, the important ones. We have the peaking index, which is going from 1 to 5. So 1 is really important. 5 is we don't care about, except if you ask the players, every competition is a 1. So we always need to take that in. Then we have all different colors up here and here, and a color represents the level of the BWF World Tour. So these three here are level 4s, as shown here. The important ones we really want to succeed in is level 2, which is All England. It was just played a couple of weeks ago. And then, of course, the Thomas and Uber Cup, the World Team Championships and the World Championships. In the bottom, down here, we have the macro, meso and micro cycle. And you can see here that the only thing we, as coaches and experts really care about is performing at All England and the World Championships. So that's actually what the annual plan tells us. So when you put in, when they're away, and they're usually somewhere in Asia, and when they have their vacations, the blank spots is what's left for physical training, strength and conditioning. So that's not much to try to do a lot. You could say this. But I would argue it's not impossible, but this is very much what it's all about. I like this quote. Really, really important to have a plan and be able to adjust that plan.